From fabulous Los Angeles, California, Hollywood, home of the stars, the magic factory where dreams come true, culture capital of the world, jewel of the Pacific, it's the Adam Carolla Show.
Yeah. Get it on. Got to get it on. No choice but to get it on. Mandate. Get it on. Welcome to the program. Thank you so much for sharing this program with a friend. We travel around. We see you. We meet you. Father and son teams coming in. Mother-daughter teams coming in.
Sounds sexy.
Yeah. It's insane to me that, you know, mom comes in and says, my daughter was a fan and turned me on to the podcast, and now I'm a fan. But I love it. Good day, Alison Rosen.
Hello, Adam Carolla.
And Bald Brian.
I absolutely love to suck cock.
Dean Dobbs wanted that one on Twitter using the hashtag top drop.
All right. Some stories from the road. Rich Eisen, NFL Network's going to come in here. Maybe the uprights thing will come up. Just maybe.
Oh, I'm unfamiliar with your thoughts about that.
Well, no. How then
okay,
just sit tight.
Wait.
Sit tight,
can't
girl.
Wait to hear it.
Sit tight, girl.
Stay tuned.
Friend.
Stay tuned. A couple of few things. So we're out on the road over the weekend. Great audiences, great shows.
Great weather.
Yeah. It rained for a change, which was weird. It was beautiful. It was hot. Then it was rainy. It rained in Chicago the following night after you guys packed it in from Minneapolis.
We were sent home.
Oh, yeah. After you're sent home from Minneapolis. Unceremoniously let go from one of the Twin Cities. So I had as far as my schedule went, well, we all flew out pretty early on Friday morning, and then we did, I did a signing, a Mangria signing, which was fairly well attended. That took an hour or so, and then just got to the theater right at 7:30, about the time the first show was going to start. Did that, did the second show, and then... Mike, the Stone Pelican, Mike August and I had a business meeting, and the only time we could do it was Saturday morning before we flew out to Chicago, before we went to Binney's and did another Mangria signing, before we did a show in Waukegan that night.
This is like an online go to meeting type thing, or is it in Chicago?
This is a business meeting in Minneapolis.
Oh.
So, of course, we want to eat at Komarczyk's or whatever the Polish joint is, although we have to schedule the meeting at 9 a.m. So we're going for Polish food at 9 a.m., but it's fine with me because I haven't eaten since I was on the airplane the day before because I snacked around a little backstage of the theater, but I didn't really sat down, had a meal, and I want some good Polish food / I don't know, it's Hungarian, I don't know, German, whatever it is.
Norwegian.
Schnitzel stuffed with everything.
Food.
White people food. Lots of cabbage stuffed with other things. And so it was comical. First off, just to go into one of those places at 9 a.m. and see what kind of...
I'm surprised they're open that early.
I said to Mike, is this place open at 9 a.m.? He said, open at 8 a.m. So we rolled in at 9, but stuff was still kind of put away. So we did the give me the stuffed cabbage and give me the veal and give me the schnitzel and give me the goulash and the whole nine yards.
They're like, oh, traditional Hungarian breakfast?
Yes. And then Mike has to order breakfast on top of the whole thing. And we have a pyramid of Polish food that's coming to the table at 9 a.m. And he's ordering the breakfast plate, too. And I said, don't do it, Mike. And he's like, I'm doing it. And it said bacon on the special, so he wanted that. But the comedy is the couple that we're meeting for this business meeting, to them, they live in Minneapolis. They eat breakfast, I guess, when people eat breakfast, and they're a young, healthy couple. he orders a coffee and a Danish and nothing more. And she orders a bowl of chicken noodle soup, and then this huge mound a Polish food shows up. I mean, huge stuff. I mean, three stuffed cabbages, schnitzels, I don't know, lynx.
Right.
Like, just being dragged. The guy couldn't carry them on one plate. He was dragging them over his shoulder.
Like sausage anal beads.
Yes. Bensage. I want fucking cabbage. That's what we had. And then, after we're stuffing ourselves to the gills, at a certain point, the guy comes out. You know when you make your point at the counter... You know that sort of satisfying and the part of life that's super satisfying and makes you super angry too when you say to someone, don't order breakfast. We're ordering everything on the menu. They're not ordering. You don't need the breakfast plate. You're already ordering. And he's like, I want breakfast. At a certain point when we're leaning back and undoing our pants, out comes the eggs, you know, sunny side up with the bacon. It gets plopped down right in front of Mike. And I'm not, now you eat it, you son of a bitch. And all I could think of is we couldn't bag it up and take it on the plane. I don't think. You can eat your food at, you can get your food after security, but you can't get your food before security.
Right. Unless
I feel like
no.
Well, you can't do bottle.
Why?
Liquids you can't.
You couldn't do
if they're runny eggs.
What if
no
you
deal.
Had like a Chipotle burrito? Oh, could you bring that on? And then what would be the difference between that and a pipe bomb? I mean, what's the difference
they're
between
both kind of pipe bombs?
Well, I'm saying, what is the difference between that and a bottle or half? You know, half a bottle of water.
Yeah.
I missed the part where they used to make you take a swig out of it.
Me too.
I like that kind of, you know.
They pull out some weird strip from out of nowhere and like rub it on it and then stick it in a machine.
The swig out of the bottle is the same idea I had for the gay games to make sure no straight guys ever infiltrated the gay games, which is just walking up and down the line of participants. Yep. And you just stop randomly in front of a guy, start sucking.
That's right.
That's right. We'll weed out the straight dudes.
And also a swig from a bottle in a way.
Mighty quick. That's right.
Would you judge him simply on willingness or on technique? Or is it a combination?
Just as I...
have to be both.
Yeah, it'd have to be both. And willingness, too. Also, I think the straight guy would just start running and yelling, I'm sorry, as he ran for the doors of the gymnasium.
Hmm.
But that's me. All right, so now you fast forward to ate the 10 pounds of Polish food, went to the airport, got on the plane, went to Chicago, went straight to Binny's. Binny's in Chicago had over 300 people show up to it, which is always feels good, but also means I'm going to be standing there for over 2.5 hours taking pictures with every human being in that place. I think we can find you a picture or two. By the time that's done, we got to get to Waukegan. And Waukegan, this isn't a great picture, but you can see.
Oh yeah, you can see
the
all the
line
people
go all the
right,
way down the thing,
in.
And this is 99% not the right picture, but you get the idea.
But the 1% really does illustrate how many people there are.
Yes, it just kept going, and again, I'm flattered, but at some point, I want them to go away. So then we sign everything, and when you're done signing 300 people's bottles, you get the move where you go down to the basement, and they open 4 cases and go, could you just sign these real quick? And there's always a part of me, I always have two thoughts. One is, no, I'm dying. The second thing is, I'll never be here again, and I want you to be happy.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll spend the extra 17 minutes standing here signing as fast as I possibly can. So then we... I think I'm going to get a nap in. I can't get a nap in. We get back. We check in the hotel, and we head out to Waukegan, which is a nice hour away from where we're staying. Get out, do the show, do the intermission, finish the show, stand outside of Waukegan to take pictures and sign bottles for another hour. And as we're driving back, getting ready to meet in the hotel lobby at 6:45 in the morning, it's raining outside. Superfan Giovanni is driving the rented Suburban. And I'm switching around through the radio stations, and this song, Paul Bryan, comes on. I don't believe anyone in the car knew the song but me, and especially...
It's
raining.
Song.
Yeah.
I never heard this song.
Probably top 10. I don't know what year. But no one had heard the song.
Cancer, and my name is Larry. And I like a woman that loves everything and everybody.
Oh, you Asians with your crazy
you
songs.
What, ladies,
I'm just guessing.
If you feel
the band still cooking
you,
in the background,
then this is what I want you to do.
It's a nice
what
jam.
Is he even talking about?
Yeah.
Talking about floating on, ladies.
He's writing a personal ad, obviously.
Spent 6 weeks as number one on the Hot Soul Singles chart. Yeah.
Did he announce he's a cancer?
Yes. And he was claimed by it some years later. No. Now, if you go number two on the Billboard, Hot 100 is where it peaked. I was trying to explain to people what songs were like in the 70s and how the black music has changed quite a bit from
yes.
like, oh, no, hey, lady. Now, if you go back, if you go to the top of the song, you get the whole band and their call signs.
You do?
Oh, yeah. But it's a little tough.
Aquarius. You're right. I was told to look at the end of the song.
Not like a woman who loves her freedom.
There's an 11-minute version, by the way, so I'm sure it was not the radio edit.
Oh, yeah.
There's a, you know, the state, there's a sketch where they start out and the guy's like, I'm Barry, Sagittarius. And I bet this is what it was spoofing.
Oh, yeah. The whole band goes through their signs and their first name.
Allison, Taurus.
Yeah.
Adam.
It's your turn. A Gemini.
Bryan, Virgo, I think. I don't know.
Oh, we'll just play this
one.
I'm
so Virgo of you to say that.
I don't know if this... I hope it's not the 11-minute version.
No, wait. Radio edit.
Libra.
Wait, so who is this?
And my name is Charles.
That's Charles.
Now I like a woman that's quiet.
Yeah.
Quiet. A woman who carries herself.
Occasionally a fat lip will quiet her down.
This universe.
By the way, you'd be shocking. It's Float On by the Floaters. But.
It's a bad name.
How's the lyrics work? Like, when you're sitting down writing the lyrics of the song and you're Charles and you're sharing it with one of the other floaters, I mean, it's just literally float. Now it's raining and we're driving between Chicago and Waukegan and these dudes are digging the jam. And then at a certain point, I was sitting in the front seat. My hand just slid over to Giovanni's thigh.
It has to.
You know what I mean?
It has to.
It's raining. I'm tired from the road. I'm lonely.
If that happened, that might be Giovanni's greatest moment on earth. Love you, Gio.
I think you're right.
Leo. My name is Paul. See, I like all women of the world. And if you understand what I'm saying, I want you to.
He loves all the women of the world.
And if you understand what he's saying, he wants you to.
I wonder if there was any controversy where the guy was like, Leo. And my name's Leo. Hold on. Leo, you got to change your name to Steve, or you got to pick another sign. But that's my sign. I know, but for the song's sake, it's weird. It's confusing.
It's not going to work.
You're a floater. Take one for the fucking floating team, would you? Float with me, baby!
Adam, you should write a soul song.
Hi.
Cancer. And my name is Larry. And I like a woman.
Larry's not a black enough name.
Everything.
Should be Lawrence.
And everybody.
I'm looking for a woman who'll just get out of the way while I watch SportsCenter and beat off.
Then this is what I want you to do.
Take my non-jack in hand. Take my magazine hand. Remind me to play this when Dag comes in next.
Is this Teddy's next song?
This has got to be Teddy's next song.
We can find the 11-minute version and give him a little bit of a bed to, like,
yeah,
you know,
because
the verse that was cut out.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Anyway, we listened to the 11-minute version three times on the way home, and then we got lost. And then at some point when we were circling the airport for the third time and it was like 12:15 and I had to be in the airport, we had to be down in the lobby at 6:15 and I started to get surly. Giovanni made this mistake. He said, I used to live in this neighborhood.
I know.
And I said, and how did you get around? Did you put a pillowcase on your head and throw you in the fucking trunk of a car? Or did you drive the streets that we're currently going in a circle on? Which I realized at the time made him feel bad. All right. I got a little... follow-up on this Kanye-Jimmy Kimmel Twitter war thing, thanks to our good friends over at HuffPo that somebody tweeted me. You guys just find all the stuff that annoys me, and then you tweet it to me, and then it works. I'm annoyed. So somebody tweeted, you can take a look at that up there, Allison. it's somebody from HuffPo wrote a article about the tweet war, Twitter war between Kanye. And if people don't realize it, Kanye did an interview overseas, said some stuff that seemed sort of stupid about leather jogging pants. Kimmel did what I would call a fairly tame spoof of it, using young kids to just recreate it, I would call the, on the offensometer, 2.5 3 Yes. I don't know. When it comes to
it
late
seems
night.
Seems fairly innocuous. Yeah.
Innocuous. When it comes to late night and what these guys get into and you know, whatever they've called, whatever presidential nominee or whatever it is, Letterman, Leno, Kimmel, whoever, whoever's gone up there and done whatever, Chris Christie, fat jokes, whatever. Mm. This is way under the Mason-Dixon line.
This isn't even personal. This is just silliness playing on words.
Yeah. Yeah. And Kanye, I don't know if we have the tape of Kanye, but Kanye talking about his leather jogging pants. And it's sort of like it's got a little bit of the jerk in it, where it's like I'm talking to you and I'm saying, hey, Brian, can you believe that Stouffer shot down my frozen lasagna pops idea? Can you believe it?
Unbelievable.
I mean, first off, people love lasagna, right?
People love lasagna.
Okay. Were you outside today?
It was
97 degrees.
Yeah, you can't have hot lasagna outside.
No, fall right off the stick.
Yeah, good luck.
This is so personal and so racist that they shot down my frozen lasagna pop idea. I can't believe it. So he has his leather jogging pants idea and is basically saying that it's sort of personal that he's been ignored.
My understanding is that what he's claiming is that he's not being taken seriously as a fashion designer because he's black versus someone like Lady Gaga, who is, people do take her seriously.
My argument is sad that we take her seriously. But if you're going to suggest leather jogging pants, maybe you won't be taken seriously. But here's his clip.
Me and Virgil are in Rome giving designs to Fendi over and over and getting our designs knocked down. Mm. Brought the leather jogging pants 6 years ago to Fendi. Mm. And they said no.
Hold on.
How many?
He was the tip of the spear of the whole leather jogging pants craze.
I think they do. They do exist, though.
Okay,
people don't actually jog in them, though.
But nobody, maybe I don't hang out with the crew that wears them.
I had the same reaction. And then someone informed me, no, like Rihanna wears them. They're the low-waisted leather pants or something.
Okay. Well, oh, Jesus Christ. I just, again, the funk. The potential for funk in that department, all animal skin, should get away.
You don't want to mix wearing leather pants and jogging.
This may be jogging pants that you don't like juicy.
Yeah, sure.
All right. But speaking of juicy, that's what my balls are going to be if everyone's jogging leather pants. But anyway, all right. So Kimmel makes fun of him by reenacting this thing. And then the HuffPo goes on to explain basically, well, you can read some of those.
Kimmel's spoof was insulting because, as Aisha Siddiqui noted last night, the sketch, quote, didn't even change his words. They literally replaced him with a child. That's how white America sees Kanye, and that's his battle. Mm-hmm. Kimmel did everything Kanye kept explaining always happens to him, not being taken seriously as a black creative. But worse still, Kimmel claimed there were two Kanyes, a bad Kanye who was behind Thursday's tweets and a good Kanye West who posed for a picture with my dad. It's easier for Kimmel, a Man Show alumnus who built his career cracking bro jokes while women in bikinis jumped on trampolines and prides himself on trolling news outlets, to dismiss real criticism as part of some foreign monster that fuels bad Kanye. It's easier for him because he's lazy and because he knows he can get away with it. Because after all, who's going to take the side of an angry black rapper when there's a grinning white comic on a major U.S. television network to stand behind? The deck is stacked in his favor.
All right. I don't know that we'll ever really fix anything in this country in terms of race relations if everything like this is taken as the network. By the way, Siddiqui, Aisha, how much do you think Kanye West made last year in our horribly racist society versus Jimmy Kimmel with the big network behind him? Kanye made $35 million last year, which is, I think, at least four times as much as Jimmy made. So,
and also,
didn't even change his words. What does that mean?
Yeah, we've said that we think that spoof is much more innocuous than, you know, many of the things he does. I don't think there's anything about, I don't think there's any racism in who he chose to target.
Well, first off, he targets everybody and anybody. I'm sure he's done way more to whoever's on Duck Dynasty or whoever's on, Boardwalk and whatever the chick, whatever
Honey
the
boo-boo?
Chick from. Well, he's probably done a ton more Honey Boo Boo. He's probably done a lot more white trash related stuff,
Snooki
and also a Snooki humor and that kind of stuff. Well, technically, she could be black at this point.
Orange trash.
But I'm just saying, when it comes out the other side, probably much more in the white trash department. But here's the thing, HuffPo. If you want to read racism into everything, go ahead. Your words are going to start falling on deaf ears. Nobody. This is the problem, right and left. You start getting into this stuff, and then people start tuning out because, okay, there's a problem with race in this country. Fine, I'm listening. Here's a good example. Oh, I see you're insane. We don't have to listen to you anymore.
I have a rare insight into this because I've actually been to a Kanye West concert. It was at the Staples Center in L.A., a fairly diverse city by any account. Vast majority white people. And I can imagine if he tours around the country, he's going to see that or something similar to that, maybe even less, but vast majority white people. So the idea that white America sees him as this some sort of bad Kanye or this monster or this whatever is absurd. White America probably accounted for more than 50%.
Well, also, when you're calling one guy the man with the network behind him and the clout behind him, don't have that guy make 20% of what the other guy made in the last tax year. Now, conversely, in 79, I saw the floaters, and I was the only white guy in the audience.
God.
So it's a totally different...
Must have been very awkward.
Did you see the bad floaters or the good floaters?
I saw the good floaters. There is no bad floaters. How dare you? All right. Rich Eisen is out there. We'll bring him in. Not yet, but in a couple of few. All right. Bald Brian, you saw a movie and you got a review, do you not?
I did. You want to hear it?
Yeah, I do.
Okay. Hooray for Baldywood. He will tell you if a movie's good. Brian will review the flicks that he's seen up on the big screen or in his Netflix queue. Before you spend bucks, remember his taste sucks. He loved that train wreck piece of shit, Transformers 2. Hooray for Baldywood.
It's not Prisoners.
Prisoners.
That's the Hugh Jackman, Jake Gyllenhaal movie about the kid abduction.
Yeah.
This is in theaters now. It is directed by, Denis Villeneuve, a Canadian director who I've never seen a film from.
Mm-hmm.
Jake Gyllenhaal, like I said, Hugh Jackman are in this, Terrence Howard, Viola Davis, Maria Bello, Melissa Leo, Paul Dano. It's a great cast. It's a top to bottom, very strong cast. Hugh Jackman and Terrence Howard are neighbors. It's Thanksgiving. Their kids are all playing together. They have two little girls. They run off and go play together, and they go missing. They turn up. They don't know where they are. They search the neighborhood. They search the houses. Search everything, and they can't find them. And it becomes a sort of there's a detective assigned to the case after they've been missing for a few hours. It's Jake Gyllenhaal, and now it's about the people unraveling as they try to find the missing kids.
Mm-hmm. Hugh Jackman seems like the greatest human being on the planet.
He's a great actor, and this is a really good example. He was fantastic in this.
Not only that, but every time he gets interviewed, he's so humble.
Polite.
He's been like with the same woman for 25 years. Mm-hmm. Like, what's going on?
Yeah, what's wrong with him?
What's wrong
with
him?
What aren't we being told?
Muscle bound and handsome.
I don't buy it.
There's nothing the guy can't
sings
do.
Well.
Yeah, he's just doing like song and dance stuff. He's doing, you know, muscle bound.
Yeah, he's Wolverine.
Wolverine stuff. He's doing this stuff. What's?
Oh my God, is he more Tom Cruise than Tom Cruise?
He is.
And he's Australian, which means he's cool.
Yeah.
You know, he likes to hang out and drink beer.
Right.
There's no doubt he'd be ruined if he was from New York or especially Los Angeles. All right, so.
Okay, on the Film Vault, we did a topic once called Top 5 Good Movies You Never Want to See Again. Mine were like Leaving Las Vegas or United 93. Good movie. Glad I saw it once. Never want to go back and visit that again. That's kind of like this. This would be a strong contender if we did that list again. Good movie. Don't want to go back and experience the kids being abducted and the search. And at one point, you see in the trailer, he captures Paul Dano. He goes to his house because he's a prime suspect, takes him and locks him in his own bathroom. It's basically, you know, tortures him to try and get information from him.
Yeah, what is the example of, I know you can watch, you know, you can see Blazing Saddles or whatever if you tuned in to, whatever Woody Allen movie you like or whatever it is, you'll wait for that scene to come around that makes you laugh, Animal House or something like that. But what is it? What does make that movie you'd never need to see again? Because there's action movies that I'll just watch from the point, you know, if I show up at almost any point of Reservoir Dogs, I'll just watch it.
Sure.
I'll watch it through.
Well, it's also a brisk 90 minutes, too. That helps.
Yeah, and you know how it's going to end and all that. But what is that that makes it a movie? I mean, I know there has to be some suspense, and then the suspense is over.
What is it that makes it a movie you don't want need to see again?
I think I'm going to answer my own question.
Please.
The movies you don't need to see again don't have a bunch of great individual scenes.
Yes.
Goodfellas, I will always watch because I will look for that scene where he's sitting with his mom and she's pulling out the picture and he's looking at the picture going, hey, I got this dog looking this way and this dog's looking this way and this guy's going, what do you want from me? And then they both start realizing it looks like the guy in the trunk.
Yep.
Or just the scene where De Niro's telling everyone to take it back or when Spider says to kiss his ass and everyone's like, good for you. And then they shoot him in the foot, you know, or shoot him in the back or whatever it was, the face. Just, you know, go get your shine box. Like, Goodfellas is the ultimate movie for that because there's 17 scenes that you're kind of waiting for. Raging Bull has a couple of those scenes. We're kind of waiting for that. But like I said, the Animal Houses have that scene. Anchorman will have that where you go, I want to wait for this scene. Then there are movies like, I don't know, take a movie like Pepillon. I'm dating myself. Steve McQueen, Dustin Hoffman, unbelievable. You want to see a guy age in a movie, watch the movie Pepillon. But that's a linear movie. It starts, it goes, there's a middle, but there's no breakout, pardon the pun, they're trying to break out of a prison camp. But there's no one scene that you're looking for inside of that movie. You're looking at the entire movie. Is that what makes a movie watchable again versus seeing this?
I agree with everything you said. I also want to throw in, if you can constantly be getting something new or be reminded, oh, I forgot about that. That's great. Like, I think Inception is a recent example of this where it's always on HBO, it seems like, or it was for a while. And I would watch it from wherever I was in the middle or 2/3 or whatever. And I'd be like, oh, that's a great scene. I forgot they did that. Or, oh, I never noticed that before. So I think that.
But
helps.
Brian, you're saying you don't want to see this one again because it was so.
Oh, yeah. This is totally opposite. This is
disturbing, right?
It was heavy. It was dreary, slow, long, 2 hours and a half. Creepy.
Really?
Creepy, sometimes hard to watch. The torture scenes were a little much, but undeniably good. Good movie.
You were this close to not beating off?
I got to be honest with you. I choose not to answer that question. No, it was good. It was a good movie. I just don't want to go back and revisit that.
Did it stay with you? Like, did you get in your car and still not beat off?
I guess so. I'll have to sit with it a little longer to see how long it sits with me. But there was a pet peeve of mine, which I hate in movies so much. And this is a little bit of a spoiler. I'll try to be as delicate as I can. So fast forward if you're dying to see spoilers. Excuse me, Prisoners. did you guys see the new Girl with the Dragon Tattoo? Came out a couple years ago.
Yeah.
No.
The new?
It was a remake. There was a remake of it.
Yeah, the Girl with the Dragon Tattoo.
Okay, so there was a Stellan Skarsgård is a semi-famous, well-known actor, and they cast him in a very minor role, and surprise, surprise, he turned out to be the bad guy. And it always bothers me when they cast someone really famous in a small role.
It's a huge spoiler.
Because you know they're not
going
to just do
that.
Why
is this guy slumming it in this little bit part? I bet it's going to be very important down the road.
Uh-huh.
And they did that in this movie a little bit. I won't say who or what. I'll just say there was someone in it where it was like, why is this person in this tiny role?
Oh, interesting. You think that telegraphs where it's going to go.
It completely telegraphs it. When there's a well-known actor in a very minor role, and you're like, "What? Why is this person slumming it in such a small role?" They're either doing the director a favor, or they're going to be very important down the road.
I don't like to contradict you, Brian, but in Staying Alive, I think
it was the John Travolta film?
That's right.
Okay.
No, the French art house flick.
At the beginning of Staying Alive,
yes.
John Travolta's walking down the Manhattan street.
Saturday Night Fever.
I know. I don't think Saturday Night
Fever.
Oh,
the sequel?
The sequel.
Okay.
He's walking down the street and he bumps into Sly Stallone and they just pass each other.
Cameo.
And Stallone never shows his face again.
He directed the
no
film.
No bigger star at the time
film.
Than Sly Stallone, and he never popped up again. He's that humble.
I've been corrected.
He's so humble a performer.
I bet
he
didn't even need to be credited.
He's so generous.
Like Jane Lynch.
So, in my movie, yeah.
That's right.
He's so generous. I think
that's a cameo.
I know.
But I'm yes, but
I don't know if that was Staying Alive. Oh, yeah, that's he was a dancer.
It had to be Staying Alive because he was the director of that film.
By the way, there is no You know the scenes, they do it in every, they do it in every movie. We're just laughing at the PSA where the bunch of chicks decide to cheat death by or attempt to cheat death by driving across the train tracks when the arms are down and signals are flashing. Because, you know, you went to high school with white chicks. You know how they drive. That's how they do it. E-braking, Brody's everywhere. And we're just laughing about that. But they always do this thing in movies that bothers me. And they do the move. They'll do that move where it's like, oh, here comes the train. And they cut to the guy on the track and he's trying to untie the chick. And they look up and the train's 100 feet away. And then they go back down and he's working on her again. Mm-hmm. And they look up and the train's 102 feet away or like almost the same distance, but the train's going. Then they show a side shot of the train. It's going 100 miles an hour.
Yeah.
And then they look up again. Yeah. And now it's a little bit closer. But in the time that passed, the thing would have run them over and stopped in Cleveland and emptied the septic tank in the time. In the time.
Yes. In the increments in which they're showing it, it doesn't measure up.
Yes. I'm sad to say this, but in Staying Alive. And we got to find that beginning scene. But we also find, we have to find this scene. The big climactic scene of the movie, Travolta is like there. Stallone got him in a fabulous shape, by the way. He's there and it's like he's making his Broadway debut. And there's this thing where there's like.
His grand entrance.
That's right. Into Broadway. So there's this thing where it's just like this lily pad that's sort of lifting up and the chick dancer's on it and she's doing the jump, take my hand, you know, and it just keeps lifting and shots of him going like, shall I do it? You know, and by the time he would have made his move, it would have been several stories away at the pace, but they'll, you know, do that. I don't like when they do it.
That is a pet peeve. I agree with that.
All right. We will look for that and I will share the Staying Alive and Stallone with the boy. I think that was the top of Stallone and his Shit Doesn't Stink.
Oh, he
era.
Had just come off of Rocky, right? Like he just came off of
Rocky, and he was going to like personally train Travolta so that he could turn him into a dancer, the body of a dancer, and he was going to direct him in this film that nobody wanted to see. Although
I think Frank Stallone did some of the music for that movie.
Oh, yeah.
I think so.
Yeah, he did. All right.
Prisoners, an effective thriller, handful of good scenes. See it once and never see it again.
All right. You can watch the beginning of Staying Alive now. We got it up there. It's a young. Who's going to let some gray go on their temples first? Who's going to let some gray go in the temples first?
Who are we choosing between?
Paul McCartney.
Okay.
John Travolta. Paul McCartney's 73 years old.
He's got at least 15 years on Travolta.
Black. And Travolta, unclear if that's his own hair anymore. But who's going to let the touch of gray pop up first on the temple? And at what point?
I feel like it should be McCartney.
Is
Travolta wearing a wig?
Let me ask this. Where's everyone's wife? You know, yeah. I always discuss this. Like,
yes.
If I just got myself a hubcap size belt buckle that said, I love knocking boots and bucking Broncos, and I bedazzled it myself, and I said, I'm now heading out of the home now, Lynette. We can go eat dinner. She'd say, where are you going with that fucking thing stuck to the front of your belt? And I'd say, I thought it looked pretty good. And she'd say, no, it doesn't look good. It's embarrassing. It looks bizarre. People are going to laugh about you behind your back. So take it off and get a regular belt. Now, where are the women in the guy's life? Travolta's hair looks like it was drawn on with a
light
Sharpie.
Doesn't pass through that.
No, because his scalp is the color of the hair. Where are the women?
And well, people are wondering that when it comes to Travolta.
Same with Sir Paul, too. Maybe he's got a lady that's just a little younger than him and doesn't.
Oh, boy.
We're looking at Travolta.
Okay, that looks like that powder spray.
Mm-hmm. Top coverage. All right. I used to love the top coverage.
And what's on his chin?
Top coverage is one of the big things with top coverage, which was the original spray-on bald spot
it was
hair.
Called GLH, but it
originally started as top coverage. It was always great because at what point they would go, won't come off an upholstery. And I just thought, That would be pretty humiliating if you had one like a white linen sofa and you're like, what is this big, huge brown scuff mark on the top of the pillow?
Skid mark. The stuff on his chin, you know that toy, the magnet thing where you take the magnet and like
Wooly
pull
Willy.
The, yes,
Wooly Willy.
He looks like Wooly Willy.
Again, I just, where are the ladies and where is their vote? That's all I'm saying.
That's a good point. Have you, you would have no need for top coverage, right?
No, I can't get it. You know, I got, my hair grows too fast, too thick, too whatever. Like, I have to go get a haircut.
Nice.
Like, it's weird. But yeah, I mean, their combined age, their combined age is, 127. And there is no.
Nary a gray.
Yeah. Maybe it's close. Could even be close to 130. Yeah, well, fine. I want their combined age.
Here's the thing for the Travoltas and the Piffins of the world. What's the worst that could happen if you go bald? Like, is Bruce Willis's career really suffering?
You could be a role model for them.
I could be. But what I'm saying is it Harris not getting nominated for Oscars? Like, there's a career out there, a very good one for bald actors.
I understand. But also, there's less questions going to be asked if you let a little touch of gray. 130 is their combined age. They're 130 years of age. There's not one fucking gray hair between the two of them. All right. Rich Heisen, as Dawson would say, is coming in. Now, he's a guy who knows what to do with his male pattern baldness. Just get that clipper on number one and give it a buzz
once a week. Yeah, there, after it.
And it shall be done. All right, yes.
Sorry to go back to this for 1 second. I think Paul McCartney is wearing a toupee because that was just too perfectly coiffed. It looked like Meg Ryan's hair, but dyed brown.
But Paul McCartney has never had, and maybe just, what the fuck do I know? Paul McCartney's never had those thinning. Like, you can see Jeremy Piven's hair, actually, it's like the tide. Mm-hmm. It's like time lapse of the tide. You can see it go back in the 90s and then make its way forward again in the 2000s. Yeah. That much you can see. I never saw any lean ears.
Running around.
Yeah, it's not fast motion.
The thing that Coke cans come in.
Yeah, it's not like Paul McCartney had a few years with Wings where you're like, oh, bad comb over, man. Speaking of Wings, look at that single wing. Yeah.
He's never gone more than a week without being photographed in his life, so it would be very hard to
have
find
the thin
picture
part and then have the wig part.
But Travolta,
right.
Yes.
So you think that's real hair is what you're saying?
Yes.
Well,
and
artificially colored, probably.
Oh.
Oh. All right. We're seeing some revealing pictures.
Of Travolta's bald head.
All right. We will take ourselves a break. Put the screen back on, please. Ah, Brea Improv tomorrow night. Christopher Titus is going to come out. So if you want to see us, come out and see us at the Brea Improv tomorrow night. We're also doing a couple shows in Portland and Seattle. That's coming up October 11th and October 12th. One is going to be at the Aladdin Theater. That's in Portland. And then the Neptune Theater. Honestly, I got to tell you, I didn't know how these shows would go, doing theater shows, doing live podcasts in theaters, but so far, so good.
You doubted us?
They've been great. Yeah, it was really myself I was questioning. But
now I know you're lying. You never doubt yourself.
Everyone showed up, and they were just great nights. So come on out to that.
I loved Minneapolis. I thought they were great crowds.
Great crowds.
Really nice.
Yeah, yes. Final thought, because I tweeted about it relentlessly. Minneapolis is quietly a hotbed of great craft beer. There were so many good beers out there. Thanks to everyone who recommended
it is,
to me.
It is Seattle of the Midwest, or it is the new Austin, or I don't know what it is, but highest gay population.
Really?
By the way, if Mike August tells me that one more time, I'm going to think he's gay, because he tells me that every 15 days. He tells me it's the highest gay population. Microbrews coming out of every spigot, and a huge live cool crowds.
Yep.
So very hip crowd. And you just never think Minneapolis. You just think Minnesota.
That's
you
up know, and
you
coming.
Think
it's
utter
not,
bomb.
Not, yeah.
And Dobber from Coach. Yet. Yes. All right. Also, Mangria bottle signings coming up. I'll do an Oregon Main Brew Liquor, and that'll be on Friday the 11th at 6 o'clock for the show. And then Seattle Esquin Wine and Spirits, and that'll be on Saturday coming up on the 12th before the show over there. So we'll connect a little Mangria signing, and we'll do it that way. Also, new shows. Pat O'Brien's doing a show. And also, Dr. Drew's beautiful wife, Susan Pinsky's doing a show. It's co-hosted with Gina Grad, and all that's available on iTunes. New episodes on every Tuesday. We'll take, Alison Rosen.
I know that
sounded horrible. Tom Segura is going to be on the show.
Uh-huh. That's this week's guest, yes.
I like Tom Segura. Also, you can get it on iTunes. You can get it on our app, and new episodes every Monday and Thursday. And you can go to AlisonRosen.com for more information.
And on the Thursday show, Gary revealed something that I didn't know was in there, which is his sexy Gary voice. You'll have to listen to hear.
We will take ourselves a quick break. We'll find Rich Eisen. We'll come back after this. Well, we're just told that Rich Eisen is not going to be able to make it in, and a pox on him. I love Rich Eisen, and it's my fault for being excited to see Rich Eisen. All right, Alison Rosen, let's do some news, baby girl.
The news with Alison Rosen.
She'll read some news from her iPad. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's bad. It's Alison, Alison. And when it's time to wrap it up, she'll sign it off with Zip It Cunt. It's Alison.
All right, I need to talk about something that's like my version of the goalposts, and that is ants going up your butt. I'm sorry to bring it up again. However, I was just in the bathroom, and there was like a bunch of ants on the above the sink. Yeah. I took a photo.
Yeah, saw one on the toilet seat here today. Mm,
I saw two on the toilet seat. Mm. Here's the thing, though. I keep saying we have an invasion.
And infestation
then,
problem.
That's what maybe I said there's a bunch of ants, and then everyone's like, what's a bunch? And so the guys are making fun of me because apparently it has to be coated black and furry and moving.
Yeah.
Like the 70s. For them to, sorry, that was a reference to a giant bush. I realize that sounded racist, and that's not what I meant. Mm-hmm. super uncomfortable right now. For them to care. So here is what I want to know. How many ants is too many ants on your toilet?
Well, one ant is too many ants. You know, it's like one hungry child.
Yeah.
It's one.
We can do better.
One too many. No, you know what? I'm going to go in advance in case another kid gets hungry.
Sure.
Two too many.
You're already two over the limit.
You're going to owe me a hungry child.
Okay. One overstuffed child.
I think no ant should be left behind. I believe it takes an ant village.
Yeah.
I saw the one lone ant. By the way, if you're an ant, the white toilet seat top is not the place to hide out. Number one. Now,
the more you know, ants.
Here's the problem. I see the one ant, and I always announce it's a scout.
Someone always does announce that.
But maybe it's just a antisocial, drunken, rogue, rambling ant.
Maybe it's a survivalist ant.
I never see a homeless guy walking alone under a bridge and go, scout, human scout.
Yeah, maybe he's the town drunk ant. No one's going to listen to him.
I know.
Yeah. Guys, the coast is clear. There's sugar everywhere.
Or maybe it's like he wouldn't stop talking about goalposts or something. They cast him out of the hill, you know? And it's true. When you see people walking alone, you go, oh, poor drunken sack of shit. But when you see the ant, he becomes Flint McCullough.
Yeah, you always assume that he's got a greater purpose.
You got to watch Wagon Train to understand who Flint McCullough was. Now we have to look up Flint McCullough from Wagon Train. All right. He was the scout on Wagon Train.
Now we know. What's Wagon Train?
He would ride ahead. It was a 50s show that it was one of those. I'm telling you now, I'm totally convinced that this happened. Somebody said, look, in the 50s, we have to produce a bunch of super horrible fucking westerns like Bonanza and Wagon Train and shows like that so that when the unborn Carolla boy wants to cut school and stay home and pretend his stomach hurts. He'll have nothing, have no alternative but to watch our horrible shows on his black and white 13-inch Zenith, and that'll make him think twice about cutting school.
Did his male camel toe look as good on the black and white Zenith does look now?
It took up 11 and a half inches of the 13-inch black and white Zenith. Flint McCullough. By the way, no fucking better gay porn name or just dude name than Flint McCullough. Flint McCullough was a scout. I'd be a horrible scout because I'd do that move where I'd go like, I'm going to ride ahead and make sure we're in Indian country. By the way, my answer, my sarcastic cowboy answer would always be, hey, Flint, tell us we're not in Indian country. Because I feel like we're always in Indian country. But anyway.
The arrows are whizzing by your head. Definitely Indian country.
I'm going to ride ahead and make sure the coast's clear. And then all I would do is ride over the mountain and take a nap and eat whatever the version of a Snickers bar was back then.
Oh, what
and
do you think it was?
Then I'd ride back.
Where's
and just
Flint?
Go,
he's been gone a long time.
I've been looking for Indians.
You were gone for a long time. You must have been really scouring the earth.
And there's dirt marks
that's
in your
not,
hair.
That's not... That's... Yeah. The Indian took a shot at me.
Did you fall off your horse?
Had to take him down with hand-to-hand combat.
It looks like you used your jacket for a pillow.
Some that's drool. What happens when you get thrown off a horse after an Indian throws a tomahawk at your back. That's exactly the patterns it takes.
So we are an Indian country then.
We're smack dab in the middle. If Indian country was a tit, we wouldn't even be near the edge of the areola. And even then, we'd still be an Indian country because we'd still be on the tit.
Is that the bumpy part?
That's sometimes bumpy. Yeah, I don't know why.
Encounter bumpy tits?
I'm saying this. We're an Indian country. So let's keep moving. I want to be moving on second son, not first son. Let's not do anything crazy.
Okay, but Flint, you always take off and you're gone for a long time.
That's
you
right,
ma'am.
You
don't get that far.
Yeah. Listen, I just go out there and float on. By the way, I'm a Virgo. My name's Flint. So Flint McCullough, sorry, the aunt, I always look at that aunt as Flint McCullough, but then I realize it could just be a stupid aunt who's lost or drunk or cast out.
You're right.
And then but I always kill him because I don't want him reporting back to the other aunts that what's going on in here. Now, we have enough aunts to be a pain in the ass around here, but not enough to call it a problem.
Mm. Aren't ants one of the easiest problems to take care of? Just a little bit of spray and a couple little
you would think,
traps.
But no.
But they never make their ant move around here. It's a couple of rogers floating around the coffee pot and a couple of rogers floating around the toilet. But they never make their move.
What do ants eat?
I don't know.
Coating the toilet seat in it.
That's the whole point. What there's something about now I feel an ant on me. There's something about moisture.
No, it's probably just a spider.
Something about moisture that brings out the ants. All right.
All right. Someone's butt condensation.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Anyway, in real news, government shut down. It happened at midnight on October 1st. Republicans and Democrats could not agree on a spending plan for the fiscal year ahead. And so the government is shut down, which sounds very ominous. It's not good, but it's non-essential services. So, for example, if you're in Yosemite, get the fuck out.
Yeah.
So park rangers, national parks, the National Zoo.
That's
got
to be a little bit of a slap in the face to the government employees who now find out that they're not. It's like, hey, we're having a Carolla family meeting, but only essential Carollas need stop by.
Non-essential personnel, don't bother.
Yeah. I always like this. I don't know why. It's like the sequestration, which is the sequestration still going on and has it been going on? And has it been a year yet? And does anyone notice? I know this is bigger, but I'm just saying, I always feel like I like it
if
when
I
government.
If I were sequestered, I'd be like, hello.
Hello.
Remember us?
The government, I would like to shrink government by quite a bit. So I'm fine with
this. A few hundred thousand, because that's what it is.
It'd be nice. It'd be nice. But the good news is for these people is they go home and then they're going to get paid anyway, right?
They're eventually
going to
make it up.
Their salaries are furloughed.
So
someone looked that up.
They get paid.
They're not getting paid currently.
They're not getting paid Friday, but they can go home for a week and a half. They can argue it. They can argue about it and then they'll get retroactively paid for whatever it is. Someone's got to look it up. I think they're going to get paid. But anyway.
I think one of the downsides is that government-funded clinical drug trials are suspended while this happens. So in particular, like kids with cancer are being turned away. Not in droves, but there are certain clinical trials that aren't happening right now.
I just think that whenever there's the doom and gloom, whatever, and I don't mean this, it's not always political, it's just whatever. Whenever one says, you don't want this to happen, do you? It never seems to affect us.
It never really matters much. Is it like when someone offers the resignation or says, I'm just going to stop coming into work, and then they do, and then nothing happens, and you're like, oh, that's not that bad, and they don't come in.
Well, I always say this whenever we do this whole presidential thing every 4 years, I think if somehow somebody was able to shield you And you went and lived your life. I always say this. You went and lived your life. You checked your savings account. You checked your work. You got to look at international news, what was going on in the Middle East and that kind of stuff. And then at the end of the 4 years, I said, do you think this guy got in? Your guy? The guy, you know, there's a guy, you're fervently for this one guy. Like, we need Obama in there, or we need Romney in there, because we don't have Romney in there, the economy's going to collapse. Or if we don't have Obama in there, the Middle East, this thing's never going to end. Whatever you said, the doom and gloom versus the good or the bad for your guy. And I said, 4 years in, what is it?
And they woke you up 4 years later, or you didn't even know who was in office.
Take a look at your checking account, your savings account. Look at your wife. Look at your kids. Look at your school. Look at you've been around watching what's going on.
What if your wife and kids change?
Yeah, the wife's 4 years older.
In foreign affairs, the whole thing, and go, where are we now? What's going on? I don't think most average people, no matter how staunch they were for one or the other, in most periods of time. Now, look, you could probably tell the difference if you're a Reagan fan versus a Jimmy Carter fan.
Sure.
But today, I don't know.
I just want to add, the furlough means they are unpaid and they won't be paid for the time they miss.
All right.
Yeah, because certain things, the stock market, property value is, will almost always go up. Like, they'll 4 years, for the most part, they'll be more than they were 4 years ago.
Yeah, it's just I have this sort of feeling that life, you know, gas goes up 30 cents a year and your house goes up and whatever, it just kind of goes. I don't know. I wonder if Obama, I wonder how many Obama fans, devotees would think that Obama after the end of the first four was that or not. I don't know. I really don't. But I don't think I could tell. Certainly not with any certainty. Mm-hmm. And if you put one of my kids on the line, especially the boy, I would not make that gamble.
And what they're saying is that if it only lasts a few days, that will not affect the economy. But if it begins to last a few weeks, that will affect our economy.
Good. Just take it all. Burn it down. Start new. I'll be the king. That's what I'm looking forward to.
What's your first move?
Raise the goalpost.
Then do we kill the ants?
We use...
Ooh, first we come for the ants.
We come for the ants. That's what they said.
It is now open enrollment for the Affordable Care Act or Obamacare.
All right. Again, I have no idea what to do, how it works, how it affects me.
Well, you have health care, right?
Obviously, I think so.
Just private. Because you don't do your union health care. You just pay for it monthly, right? For your family.
No, I'm in unions.
Oh, so you use the union
I
healthcare.
Don't want to be in them.
Okay. But you have it.
I have it, yeah. And every time one of these asshole union dicks says to me, oh, what about your health care? Well, first off, I don't even really have a doctor, number one. Number two, yes, I do use my union health care on the rare chance that I do something, except for if I just bought it privately, it would cost a lot less than whatever the unions are extracting
for me. It's one of those things where, as long as you're being forced to spend, you may as well use it. It's like, I'm being forced to lease this much more expensive car than I want. I might as well drive it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So what does that mean, Botox?
That's exactly what it means.
Somebody said to me, some asswipe tweeted me the other day that said, like, well, what's the difference? But you have baby doll Dixon. Baby doll Dixon, you know, gets in there and gets you a fair wage. And what's the difference between him and a union? And I said, he doesn't represent every comedian in the United States.
Someone thought having an agent was like being in a union? It's kind of the opposite.
There's stupid people out there. Yeah.
He's trying to get you more than everyone else.
He is, but if you go to Zany's and you go, Adam Carolla wants $100,000 to do one show, they'll go, fuck off. Yeah. We can get Doug Benson for $5,000, and that'll be that. That's how the real world works.
Oh, and a Kanye update. He deleted his Twitter rant.
Oh.
I wonder how that HuffPo person ought to fucking delete their computer. Dicks. Where were we?
The Breaking Bad finale logged a record 10.3 million viewers. Now, Adam, I know that you're not up on your Breaking Bad, so I'm now talking to people who do watch. Which
well, now
is,
I got
the
a,
listeners.
Now I got a problem.
All right,
because Lynette forced me to sit down and watch the first episode
of the whole show.
Of the whole show.
Okay.
So I watched the first episode of the whole show. Yes, and then I found out that on Sunday night, they were doing the whole thing at the cemetery.
Oh, yeah.
And I think Jimmy was going to be out there or something.
He was there.
And Lynette said, ooh, let's go whatever. And I said, yeah, let's go over there. And then Jimmy said, no.
He wouldn't let you.
Because you haven't seen it?
He said, it's not going to be good for you.
It's true.
To see the first one and see the last one. So I forbid
for
you from going.
Yeah. So for the listeners, they were airing the finale at the Hollywood Forever Cemetery. I believe that's what it's called.
Yeah.
As opposed to, what, a cemetery that's not forever. But anyway, and they did, so Chris
they
Hardwick posts Talking Bad, and I think he filmed it with Jimmy Kimmel afterwards.
They show movies there. They have like Hollywood Night, whatever. By the way, spread a blanket out on a loved one, decomposing body. But you spread the blanket out, they put the big inflatable screen there, and, you know, I don't know if it's all horror movies or whatever they'll show there, but they'll just show anything there, right?
I think they have rom-coms there.
Right. So they'll show movies there, and it's kind of fun, picnicky, kind of funky Hollywood fun.
Have you guys both been?
No.
Hell no.
Okay. It sounds like pure hell. Every time a friend brings it up, we should do this, but under no circumstances.
But the reason that I wouldn't do it is because I don't enjoy hanging out in cemeteries.
Also, this appeal.
Or the outdoors.
Whether it's a picnic or a movie, hey, spread a blanket out on the ground and sit on it.
Yeah.
Doesn't sound appealing to me.
Sit on a couch. I went to Crate and Barrel.
Yeah. Like.
Indoors.
I want fucking something. Let's just go ahead and apply that to anything. Like, hey, you could have a seat on the Southwest flight, or you could take a towel and put it on the floor and sit on that. Like, you'd go, well, fuck that.
Yeah, sitting Indian style, I got over that in about third grade.
Or at the dentist's office. Well, you could sit in the chair, or if you like, I can take this towel and throw it out on the linoleum. You could lay down there and he could work on you there. Like, it just, it's not exciting to sit on the ground on a piece of cloth.
At the beach, maybe, but not like this. This
I
is
would
nice.
Even prefer the beach if
even
there was
the beach is good because you can carve a nice recliner shape into the sand. You kind of nice ass groove in there.
Yeah,
this I don't know. So anyway, I was forbidden for showing up at this thing because I could not watch the last episode.
Yeah, I agree.
And
would
the
not
first
have been
episode.
Good for you. You know, what's an interesting group of people? The adults who voluntarily sit cross-legged on the ground anywhere. I don't mean spreading out a thing. I just mean, you know.
Yeah.
Haven't you been around those? Like, I bet there's people who sit on the ground here, right on the ants.
I had a buddy named Carl who used to sit on his foot. Like, when he sat on a chair, he would sit on his foot, and it bothered me. What is that? It hurts. You're making me uncomfortable, and you're getting sneaker shit all over your ass crack.
Yeah.
All right, so.
So Breaking Bad.
Breaking Bad, 10
so
point something
now?
Million. Oh, it's a great show.
Are you going to watch the rest?
I may.
You should, but you're going to have to try to avoid spoilers.
Like, Jimmy will say to me all the time, he goes, listen, I know you don't watch good shows. And I go, but I love your show. No, I know you don't watch good shows. I know that's your policy. You don't like to support quality art.
Mm-hmm.
And
that's your stance.
And that's my stance. And I go, I just don't. And he goes, but you have to watch this one. So now I'm going to have to. I'm not going to watch The Wire, but I will watch.
Right.
I will
you
watch
draw a line
this.
Somewhere.
Right. I have seen Patrick Dempsey's Le Mans racing video, his four-part series. I've seen each episode like 12 times. All right, I just drink red wine and watch the same stuff over and over again. It has to have something to do with cars or, you know, football highlights. Mm. That's all it is. All right.
So there's controversy is not the right word, but there's some discussion around the finale, and I'm going to do this without spoilers.
Oh, I think you can spoil all you want at this point. It's all over the internet. What?
Did you know that when you spoil...
I mean, look, people tweeted me that he died or died doing what he loved or whatever it was. I mean, look, if you haven't gotten to it by now, you haven't gotten to it.
What are you talking about?
Did you know that the Porcelain Punisher is so spoiler averse that first he doesn't want to watch a trailer, and when someone's talking about something and he's afraid that it'll spoil it, he puts his fingers in his ears and like pumps them in and out, thinking that'll somehow block the sound.
This is 100% true. I've witnessed it.
Wow.
That's how much he doesn't want things spoiled. So I'm going to attempt to do this with no ear pumping necessary. I really enjoyed the finale, and I liked that I felt a sense of closure and that it really wrapped things up.
The consensus seemed to be was really good.
But then there are people who are saying that it wasn't in keeping with the show because the show was kind of messy, whereas this tied up all the loose ends. And my question is, do you ever want a finale that leaves a lot of questions?
No. Couple things. TV show finales are like Oscar host. It's like as soon as somebody says, I think Jon Stewart was awesome, someone will pipe up and go, oh, he was horrible.
Yeah.
So there's no winning that game. we can all sort of agree, although I thought we could all agree, when Brian, in front of Phil Rosenthal the other night, brought up the season finale of Sopranos and saying, I hated it.
I said I loved it. Oh, you said you loved it. It's gotten better with time.
And Phil Rosenthal said he hated it. And
that was kind of open-ended. I mean, it certainly didn't give a very satisfying
conclusion. But there you are. There's two smart guys, one exquisitely rich and successful, the other incredibly poor. But yet, two smart
guys.
It's a real
rich man, poor man.
One person's figured out a way to turn that into a nickel. Yeah. It has not yet.
Yeah, the other one does sound effects.
Right. But
it's not a way to talk about Phil.
Two super smart guys who know their way around a TV set, movies and criticism and all that. Two different, huge fans of Sopranos, totally different takes.
Right.
On the end. So there you go. It's kind of hard to win. Although I think what you get is a consensus, which is everyone disappointed with Lost.
Yes.
Which I never watched. But everyone disappointed with Lost and not so many disappointed with Breaking Bad. And if your argument is they tied up too many things for the last episode that I'll be created, cry me a fucking river.
Yeah, and let me just say that I think that ambiguous endings can sometimes be really cool. Like, oh, what do you think happened there? Did you know?
Yeah,
what,
I agree.
Prisoners had an ambiguous ending. I won't say what happened, but the last shot, you're like, I think I know what's going to happen next, but then it went to black, and it was like, oh, tantalizing.
Yeah.
It's cool. Mm-hmm. I like that sometimes.
I never watched Lost, but I find Lost is one of those that you can admit you never watched, and people will be like, ugh, you're lucky. Because they're angry about the way it ended. Whereas other ones, like, because I'm like you, I haven't seen The Wire, and I've gotten an earful of, oh, yeah. No.
I don't get any credit, though. Like, a lot of people, you know, I go, I've never seen The Wire, and a lot of people, for a lot of people, you get the credit. Like, you go, because I'm reading all the time, I don't own a TV. But for me, I've seen Corvette Summer for the 128th time, and that's the reason why I couldn't get to The Wire. And that's what people, they know I'm, you know, intellectual lightweight, so I don't
get... Well, you brag about never having finished a book.
Yeah. Never liked a book I ever finished, or something like that. Yeah. All right, what else we got?
Well, the National Toy Hall of Fame has narrowed the nominees for its class of 2013. Mm. These are the nominees for the National Toy Hall of Fame. Bubbles, assuming that just means the bubbles that you blow.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
They
allowed a stick in a while ago. They're real loose with the toys.
The stick the kid in the knickers hits
the hoop
with?
I think just a stick.
Stick
the hoop's not in yet?
What a snub.
No. And the stick said, you take in the hoop or I'm not joining.
That's like Malone getting in, but Stockton doesn't make it.
Yeah, the stick and the hoop ran a great pick and roll for years.
All right.
Allison, sorry.
Did that exist in the real world or is that only in movies? Stick and hoop.
It's in drawings from the turn of the century.
Then those are practically Instagram photos. Mm-hmm. Okay, chess, the board game Clue, Fisher Price Little People. I don't know what those are. Mm. Little Green Army Men, the Magic 8 Ball. Yes to that, I say.
Mm-hmm. How long has this Hall of Fame been around that some of these things aren't already in? How is chess not in the Hall of Fame?
Yeah, how, when, and where is this? Because if it's in Ohio,
Canton,
I'm going to be fucking pissed.
Yeah, if it's in some woman's basement, we'd be very upset.
My Little Pony. Nerf toys. I think it's interesting that they're considering Nerf toys as a block.
Yeah.
Pac-Man, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, the scooter, and the rubber duck.
We're too much fucking range here.
Yeah, this doesn't feel official.
Oh, it's in Rochester.
Oh.
And it's 15 years old.
New York or Minnesota?
It's got to be New York.
The Strong Museum in Rochester, New York.
All right. Gotten the Minnesota-New York argument before with Dr. Drew. That's why I bring it up. Where were we?
YouTube is changing the way that they do their commenting system. Right now, just whoever does the most recent comment shows up at the top of the commenting thing under a video. Mm-hmm. But they are going to use several factors to determine what pops up. So, for example, posts by the video creator or popular personalities. That would be us, you guys. Mm-hmm. Posts with engaged conversations, posts from your Google Plus friends will appear at the top of the stream. So it'll be different for different people looking.
Would you take a happy filter on your computer? Like they talk about filters on cable TV or satellite for the children. Would you take a happy filter? If you put something up on YouTube, let's say, and you want to see people's reaction, and it's like, hey, douche fuck, this fucking sucks, whale cock douche. And that's the first one.
You can actually, you'll be able to filter out certain words.
Keywords like whale cock.
And douche cock. Uh-huh. Only the cocks.
Yeah.
With cocks, comma, mm-hmm. whales, and douche. Oh, I would be tempted to. But then I'd be like, no, really, I should just get used to whale cock and douche cock.
Mm-hmm.
So that then I'm not vulnerable
mm-hmm.
if I'm without the filter. But I would be tempted.
Yeah.
I'd be tempted to. Because I think
you got to limber up for whale cock.
Well, how do you start training, though?
Well, you start with a norwhal or one of the smaller whale variety.
Right, right.
Yeah. I think the norwhals. Find out the average
length. I think blue whales are actually smallish.
Blue, small. No, I think blues are huge.
Oh, are they?
Yeah, blues are
thank
the biggest.
Thank you. I didn't make that mistake.
Yeah, you don't start with the blue whale.
That would be
yeah, the
lethal.
Blue whale's the big one. Sperm whale's a big one, too. I think the blue's the biggest of all there. But norwhal, now that's a whale you could start with. And then you work your way up, like mm-hmm. you know, like graduated, butt plugs. Not that I know a lot about that business. I know a fair bit
Sounds
about
like
that
you know
business.
A little bit.
I don't. Well, I know. Obviously, I know the Lucite graduated butt plug business, but I wouldn't know. Other compounds.
Mm-hmm. These are not terms the average person would know, especially about butt plugs.
Look, the fact that the average butt plugs is 77 millimeters tall and weighs 3.2 ounces is the kind of thing that I do feel like most people know.
I consider myself pretty well-read, and I don't know that. I've never encountered that information. I don't even know what they're made out of.
I don't sit around and talk about the circumference of the average butt plug, 41.2
You just did.
Millimeters. That would obviously be, actually, that's the width, circumference. If you want to just talk about the circumference, that's 72.22 millimeters, which is roughly 2 13/16.
You know, they're making up these numbers with remarkable
I took geometry. We
yeah.
never learned that.
I'm not some kind of fucking weird butt plug fan. Yeah, I got a couple rolled around in my car, but that's no big deal. Several of them came with the car. Yes, I supplemented, the original.
I just bought a car, and I did not receive a butt plug option. Should I go back to the dealer?
Okay. Now, you know what? First off, this is comical that you guys are accusing me of being a fan of butt plug.
You seem to know a lot. Seem versed.
Maybe there was a butt plug or nine in the glove box when I got the car, or maybe I put them there. I don't know. I don't remember.
Well, the difference seems important.
At this point. And maybe, yes, there's a couple in the rear, pardon the pun, in case I break down.
How would that be helpful?
Because I cannot get to my silo of butt plugs that I keep in my home, okay?
Okay.
And I may be waiting several minutes up to an hour for the AAA guy to come. Mm. And oftentimes, because I've checked, those guys do not carry butt plugs. And the ones that do, mum's the word. You know, it's not something they brag about.
Well,
if I have to go down to use my app to find the closest butt plug emporium, for instance, I could be walking through a very, very dicey part of the neighborhood looking for the butt plug emporium for Herb, who's the manager, although he doesn't work daytimes. He works night shifts at the butt plug emporium. That's off of Reseda. That's catty corner to the Hughes Market. It used to be Hughes. It's an Albertsons now. All right. Your tone. I don't like your tone. Is what I'm saying.
We just think it's interesting. We think it's interesting that you have us. I mean, you have a silo of
and
butt
I know,
plugs at home?
I know where the...
Of butt plugs.
Well, first off, it's not a large silo.
Yeah, silos come in many different sizes.
Yeah, it's a medium to large silo, but it's not a ginormous silo.
I mean, how many butt plugs are in it?
Well, first off, what butt plugs are we talking about? Are we talking about the self-insertion or the mount insertion?
Or the what?
Well, there's obviously they're the ones that are inserted through one's own hand, and then there's the mounting ones, the ones that come with ones that have a base.
Okay.
That one would take a warm bath, sitz bath oftentimes,
right.
Dilate,
okay.
You know, the area.
That makes sense.
Now, obviously, not all water-soluble lubes were created equal, so don't just go, to Joe Blow water soluble lube place and just grab whatever's closest to the door. Step up to something that's, if it, it if it's less than $5, don't even pick it up. And then what I do is I'll put it in the microwave with the butt plug.
The lube and the butt plug?
Yeah, well, not together. Oh. Because whether the lube
becomes... don't make that mistake.
First off, it's too viscous if it comes out at room temperature, but when you heat it up, it'll slide right off the butt plug. So what I'll do is I'll warm up the butt plug in the microwave.
Okay.
33 seconds, not 30 seconds.
Does it get
seconds,
too hot if you go too long?
Well, I immerse it in water.
Oh, it's smart.
And then the water heats it up because otherwise it just doesn't hold up well. Okay. I mean, it'll work for the first 1,500 times you do it, but long run... If you really want to get your use out of it.
I understand you want, it's an investment in you.
Right. And the fact, and I know you guys are going to go, but Adam, if you're not so into butt plugs, why did you have your car seat removed and a butt plug put in its place?
I was going to ask that.
I was thinking that too.
Yeah, that seems like
okay,
the
first
activity
off,
of someone who's very far into their butt plug. Do either one of you have children?
No.
Then you don't know anything about safety or being a father, do you?
I feel like I know something about safety, regardless of
a bit,
okay,
yeah.
But until you've been a father, you don't realize how important that role is.
We both have fathers. We've known a lot of fathers.
Okay, let me say this. I'm driving along. Mm-hmm. I'm just sitting in your conventional death seat, as I call it.
Okay.
And all of a sudden, head-on collision through the windshield.
Yeah.
But with butt plug... Quick contraction.
You're anchored.
Not going anywhere.
Can I just be the first to say that your story of why you're not really into butt plugs that you just told us really checks out and really holds water, and I would like to be the first to apologize.
I'm not going to sit here and pretend like I've never heard, like I'm going to go, what? Butt plug? What is the? What are those two words put together? I've never heard of that. No, I'm not going to sit here and do that. Yes, I've heard of butt plugs. Yes, I have a membership in a butt plug of the month club. Yes, I own a chain of stores throughout the United States that sells butt plugs. Yes, I have many of the molds of the prototypes that have been brought over from parts of Asia that I use to make my own butt plugs. Yes! As you can find me oftentimes in the Butt Plug Museum, which is in Rochester, Minnesota, by the way. Not New York. Yes, you can find me as a curator at the Butt Plug Museum. Yes, I admit to all that, but so, am I into butt plugs? Hardly.
So you're a home plugger.
That's right. And see. Thank you.
That's the news. I'm Alison Rosen. Zip it, cunts.
That was the news with Alison Rosen.
Ah.
Like anal beads.
Now, just because I commissioned a dirigible shaped like a butt plug.
Again, these are
and intend to fly it over the Super Bowl this year.
If you were just, it just seems like a casual relationship with butt plugs. Like, you wouldn't be doing this.
You don't think so?
I don't mean to accuse.
Well, you sure sound like it, monkey nipples. Oh, yes. There's a strong air of accusation in your voice.
As long as I've walked God's green earth, I've never met someone who's done all this.
Am this close to taking the two butt plugs I currently have in me and removing them and putting them in my ears. Okay?
Yeah, why two?
I kind of have to know. Are they in succession or are they side by side?
Tandem?
They start off tandemly. Obviously, I'm not a weirdo.
I'm sorry for implying.
But throughout the course of the day and weekend, yes, they can shift around like luggage in an overhead compartment.
Oh, like the announcement, please be careful when you open.
Yeah.
Luggage contents may have shifted. Just shifted.
Shift, replace content with butt plug. Okay. And yes, they go in sequentially like a train, but oftentimes come out.
Yeah.
Like Siamese twins.
If there's turbulence.
Yes. Okay. And I'm this close to removing those two, using my butt plug squire that I keep with me at all times, Jermaine. I'm this close to summoning Jermaine to remove these butt plugs and place in my ear so I no longer have to hear the lies.
Yes.
That you levy toward me.
About you being way too into butt plugs.
Yes.
No, it's no judgment.
Yeah, I mean,
to each his own.
It's fine if you want.
Yeah, hey, congratulations on your butt plug silo and your.
If you think your condescending tone now is going to get me to open up about my
passing interest
for butt plugs, it's not. The fact that you tell me it's okay.
I've
seen the good butt plug, bad butt plug moved on many times with the cop going, you know, I understand you get a little upset at your old lady. Sometimes
I just
want
to hear more.
Her.
I just want to know you and I want to know what you're into. And it seems like butt plugs are high on the list.
Look, again, people assume that because a guy has a dream catcher fashion of butt plugs that he hangs above his children's bed, that because he sleeps in a bed that's shaped like a butt plug, and because he has, again, a medium to large size silo, and
seems like a safe assumption
that he is into it. Well, you would be wrong. And that's why you don't assume, because when you assume, you make an ass, which is quickly fill the butt plug out of you and me.
I've learned a lesson here today.
That's right.
Getting so worked up about it for someone who's not super into butt plugs.
I will. And by the way, I don't threaten women because that's not my way, but I'm this close to lifting up the front of my shirt, hitting the Ice Cream Man change dispenser that I've had modified to hold butt plugs, and pulling one out and casting it at you right now. Okay?
I don't think that's necessary.
Okay?
Okay, I see. Okay, fine. You're not into butt plugs.
Will it be a suction cup variety? Will it be a free-formed hand use one? I don't know.
I didn't know they come in that variety.
I'm going to make that a surprise for you.
Okay.
Thanks. Oh, yes.
I look forward to being hit with a butt plug.
And I've got
from
a
the change belt.
From your modified change belt.
I just want to say this right now. If Walter Bozeman, the man who pioneered the butt plug. Who? Walter Bozeman.
Wally.
Wally Walter Bozeman, the man who pioneered the butt plug in 1871, was here right now.
See, I never,
to hear you,
never
what?
Heard it.
Oh, please. Everyone probably, knows that's a household name.
Maybe you,
that's like Jacuzzi.
They don't teach history well in school anymore. But I never encountered this Wally Bozeman of the
Walter
butt plugs.
Walter Bozeman, if he was here right now to hear what you, this blasphemous, what comes from the tongues of you two about this saint's product, this hero's product, he would never stop vomiting into his butt plug.
Well, thank God he's not.
And you say, "What? How do you vomit?" Yes, many of them.
I was wondering.
Many of them have cavities in order to accept other butt plugs, like this Russian doll.
Like Russian nesting butt plugs.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay. Obviously,
great.
Those aren't the ones with the suction base. Okay. Again, I am going to go out to the butt plug mobile, and I'm going to drive home, and I'm going to pretend this never happened. Understand me?
We'll never speak of it again.
Please. Please. All right. I want to, well, Rich Eisen didn't show up, but I'll thank him next time he shows up. I want to thank you guys for going to Amazon, going to adamcarolla.com and clicking through Amazon and telling a friend about the show and being such great, wonderful fans as we all experienced out in the Varsity Theater in Minneapolis on Friday night. And I experienced in Waukegan on Saturday night. So, until next time, Adam Carolla for Alison Rosenball, Bryan saying, mahalo. I love knocking boots and bucking broncos. Hey, kiddies, don't forget to subscribe to my channel and catch any podcasts you might have missed at youtube.com/Adam Carolla. That's youtube.com/me.